Good morning or good day, depending on how long you're awake for already. We had the co-production market party last night. So for me, it's very early morning now. Welcome to our session, Blank Page Stories, where we will talk about this whole process of how to get an idea first onto the page and then onto the screen. My name is Kati Bildhauer. I work for the Berlinale co-production market, Berlinale Talents, and Berlinale Residency. And in my function as Berlinale Residency, I had the honor of spending 3 months last year with these two great artists sitting next to me. It's Ella Mancheva from Kalmykia in Russia and Fernando EIMBCKE from Mexico. These are two. These are two of the three filmmakers we invited for the past edition of the Berlinale Residency. It's a program that runs for 3 months. We invite the filmmakers to Berlin. We help them develop their projects further with the help of script consultants and industry mentors. We also get their producers on board. We have Jelena Glickmann and Victoria Lupik, Ella's producers, here in the audience today. In February for the festival, the producers and directors return to Berlin to present their project at the Berlinale co-production market to find producers, co-producers and financiers and sales agents for the project. That is just the background of what we do in Berlinale Residency. And I would like to briefly introduce the filmmakers to you. So Ella is the first director coming from Kalmykia ever, so not only the first female, but the first director ever from Kalmykia. She was a talent in 2013, and her debut feature, The Gulls, premiered in Berlinale Forum in 2014, 1 year later. And now she's working on her second 15, right, and now she's working on her second feature film, Tacha, and we will talk about this later, or the whole session through. And Fernando EIMBCKE was a talent in 2003, where Berlinale Talents was the first, you know, the first edition. That was still a big experiment. You won't believe how chaotic it was, but... And his debut feature, Temporada de Patos, Duck Season, premiered in 2004 in Guadalajara and in the Semana de la Critique in Cannes. Then you did Lake Tahoe, which was in Berlinale competition in 2008 and won the Silver Bear Alfred Bauer Prize, among others. Then you returned to Berlinale with an episode of Revolution, which screened in Berlinale Special in 2010. And your third feature was Club Sandwich, which was done in 2013 and was in San Sebastian in Torino. And now you're working on your fourth feature called Diary of an Elephant. Okay, so, oh yeah, and whoever has questions, just raise your hands. We'll be happy to take any questions throughout the session. You don't have to wait until the end to come up with questions. All right, so I'd like to start with Ella. Ella, I know from Ella that she wrote her first script in quite a short time, and I'd like to ask you how the idea of The Gulls came about and how you managed to put that onto the page.
Hello, everyone. I'm so happy to be here today. Thank you very much for coming. And The Gulls, yes, I was lucky, and now I know that I was really lucky because I wrote the script for 5 days. And now I'm writing Tacha during the 1 year. And yes.
So it doesn't get easier, yeah? 5 days, yes, 1 year.
Yeah. And it was like a flash, and because now I know why it was happened, because I was, I bought it. During these 5 days, I put all my life, and it was like a memory from my childhood, from my parents, relatives, friends, and Kalmykia, a place where I was born. And it was easier to write. I didn't know about how I knew about all these characters, all these relationships, and this story. I just have a story about the woman who was waiting for her husband, and but she didn't like him, and it was one of the main line of the script, but I didn't know anything about this story. I just sat on the chair and start to write, and I can't stop during the 5 days. Thank you for my mother-in-law, because during these 5 days I asked her to look after my children. Yes, because I was in maternity leave. And yes, and after 5 days I have this, it was a very small script, 26 pages, and my brave producer, and I can imagine how she decided to to put it in production, because it's too, it's very small. Mm-hmm. And but I add some details on the script after when we shot the teaser of the script, because I know my short films was not so successful. I don't know, though, because I wanted to make something strange and very, very strange, and I discovered myself, and I knew that I need to show how I can with some images, and I decided to show the teaser of this in the script. And we were lucky because the weather during these 4 days, we didn't have any lot of money, just maybe, I don't know how to say in euro, but very, very, very small amount of money. And during these 4 days, the weather was really so sensitive and fog, and which we need some this weather. And some people which we met was really helpful for us and were very kind. And we shoot 30% of the script during 4 days. And when I edited this teaser, nobody believed us that we didn't shoot the whole film, because it was looking like a full, like a trailer. And you can imagine that it's like a short, some part of the script. And it was really helpful for me, because when some producer or some people who wants to help me, they see this teaser, they wanted to read the script so very fast. It was really nice. And The Girls was published in the very well-known Russian magazine, cinema magazine.
The script of The Guard was published.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it was one of the main points when we attracted some attention from the powerful people from the Russian film industry. It was a really good sign. And after that, when I met my producer, Lena Glickman, we won the pitching in famous the best Russian festival Kinotaur, and we won the pitching of this festival, and we and the Ministry of Culture supported us of Russian Federation. It was the first time when they put their view to to small. To the cinema of small nationality, because you know in Russia, it's not just Russian people; it consists of more than 120 nationalities. Mm-hmm. And the Kalmyk, it's a very small region; it's a republic in the south of Russia. And we didn't have any film industry, and we didn't have any directors. And show some examples for to producers or for people who can help me to make this film.
In order to help the audience understand, you know, the
the world of Kermicki and the atmosphere, because Ella's new project, Hachal, is also set in this region, and it needs to have, like, all her stories live from your heritage and this cultural heritage. So I would like to screen the first clip of Ella, so that you have an idea. I would like to know how many of you are writers. Can you raise your hands, please? Okay. Directors? Okay. The rest is? Okay. All right. I'm not a filmmaker myself, but from speaking to many filmmakers, I think the first feature you do is mostly something that has been growing inside of you, and there's like, you need to get this out. So this there's an idea, you don't have to find it, but it found you and it possesses you, and this needs to get out, and it's, you know, it has to do with family or your cultural heritage or so on. And then when we, Fernando and I just had a look at the description of our session, and Fernando said, well, you don't find a good idea. You just have an idea, and then, you know, you might find out that's been good. And I would like to share you to share with the audience, please, what the idea was for Lake for duck season, because I think it's hilarious.
Yes, as Hugh said, a film is often conceived with a good idea. It's very difficult to decide which could be a good idea. It's almost impossible. You have to go on the, to write the script, to go on a long, long, long trip to find if it's a good idea, because you can spend a lot of time saying, oh, I have this idea. It's so good? No, maybe it's not so good. So there's not such a thing as a good idea. Actually, I don't trust in the good ideas. And a lot of times you can see a film and you say, oh, they trust a lot in the so-called good idea. So, I don't know. I don't trust too much in the good ideas. I think that there's an idea, and actually, it's very difficult to have a good idea, because it's the same story in the films. It's the same story. It's not so much stories. It's a characters looking for love. It's the it's the only idea. The story with Duck Season was a very silly and stupid idea about four characters that don't have anything to do in a Sunday. So it was like, oh, it's
we I went with that. Producer. I love that. I mean, seriously, that is the core of this film, is four guys not having anything to do. I love that.
And we presented the film with fundings, and everybody was like, wow, that's a very stupid idea. But we were very lucky, because we had a very good producer that he pushed the story, these committees and this funding. So we are really, really lucky. But yes, I don't trust too much in the good ideas.
But when did you decide it is a good idea, actually, for characters not having anything to do on a Sunday?
When I never asked myself if it was a good idea. I fell in love with the characters. When we were developing the script, we worked a lot with the characters, and I fell in love with them, and I said, okay, I have to tell the story of these characters.
But you say when we developed the script, who's we?
There's a lot. Yes, it's Paula Markovic. We worked together in a workshop, and
Paula Markovic is a filmmaker who did The Price, among others.
Yes. And also I say we, because there's also the producer, there's also the DOP, there's also the actors. The story is not just in the script, it's in the process of making the film.
But at one point you decided you want to write a script on four characters being bored. Yes. And yes, that is something you decide for yourself, and you start writing on your own?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So you, when you start writing, you deal with the characters first, or you come up with scenes, or do you write a treatment? How do you do it usually?
We did like that thing called paradigma. we designed the story in a line. It was like a choral film, so we designed the different characters like Ulises, Moco, Flama, and Rita. It was like a musical score, so we designed the plots with the characters, and it was very academic designed, like the first turning point, second turning point, the climax, but that helped us to knew where we going and to discover the conflict of every character. That was the most important. And then Paula recommended me to work in a biography of each character, and it was very natural because I wrote it in first person, not in third person. It was in first person, so I don't know, maybe a lot was of me there, but I don't know. But it was like a, I don't know, very, very, like 10, 50 pages about characters. Yes, it was. I think it goes like a matching a structure, dramatic structure, and characters. They go like by hand. And one important thing I would like to say that when we work in the script for a long time, so the beginning was like the we were establishing the relation between Flama and Moco, and I sent the script to the DOP, and it was like a 12 years ago, so the internet was not so really good. So I sent a kind of archivo, a document, and I don't know how the first chapter get lost in the, and the DOP read it without that first chapter, and he said it's great, it's good, and I was like, no, there's no the first chapter, and we're like, no, it's good, but it works. So we took out the first chapter. That actually, one should do that in the films. One, I don't remember, but a very famous filmmaker said that we should burn the first reels of a film, because it's like a setting, like a explaining who's the characters, and that's really boring. So that's what happened here. So.
And since you already made 3 feature films and are working on your 4th, has anything changed in your process, or does it still happen the same way? You think of something and then you do characters, and
it's the same way, yeah. The same way, the same horrible way. Yes, it's like a going into the blank page and yes, asking, working, trying to figure out what is the story about, and yes, working and working and working. It's the same. It's the same. And I hope it will remain the same.
Yes. And you usually work with a co-writer or with another creative person you can exchange with, right?
Yes, in Doc Season, Paula was like some kind of, we call it, advisor. We like it a lot. So in the second one, we worked together. It was like we shared our universe. In the third one, I wrote it by myself, and I didn't enjoy it so much. I like to write with someone to share, to talk with someone. It's really good. You learn from that process. So doing by myself, I didn't enjoy it.
Okay. And for you, it was quite different because you were on your own. You
no, but I'm waiting for my co-writer. I hope I will meet him. Oh, sure. I don't know. It's like I'm not a writer, but I'm writing just for myself, and because I don't have a co-writer. Yes.
Guys, anyone? You know.
Yes, and. One of the main problem, I think, if you are writing for yourself, you don't explain so properly because you know a lot of details, some atmosphere, and you don't need this to find some words to explain these moments. But if some different person, people, they are reading this script, they have to understand more because they don't. They can't go to your mind and to feel what you want to say, and now I have a great experience 1 year writing, and now I'm working for this about this moment. I have to write more properly and say more than I want. Yes.
Sorry. But because I think that to write a script and to make films is in some way it's like a contradiction, because you want to make a film and you want to tell what you want to say, whatever it is, with image and sounds. So going into the writing process, I don't know how good.
It feels like going into the wrong direction, doesn't it?
Because maybe it's not. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Sometimes I realize that, and I'm writing writing the script, and it's like, I'm not a writer. I never thought I wanted to be a writer. I want to be a filmmaker, and I want to make stories with image and sounds, and to put them on paper. It's really, really, really difficult. And maybe it's sometimes it's some kind of lie. You are lying to yourself. Yeah. I don't know.
So for you, it's really just a necessary interim step between, because you can't get it out of here onto the screen, but people like producers, financiers, so on, they need to see something written first. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Maybe there's a process that we did on Lake Tahoe. Mm-hmm. We developed it was the story about a boy looking for a car, but very simple. And then we wrote the script, and then I get some kind of lost, so I did a step outline. Mm-hmm. The seed field process recommends you to go with the step outline and the treatment and then the script. I think that that's maybe not the best way. Maybe you should go and write the script, like don't thinking too much, writing and letting the characters take you wherever they want to take you, mm-hmm. and then make a step outline. And that I think that step outline is the most important thing, because it's not so complicated, it's not like, it's like bits of actions, it's like this, mm-hmm. and this and this. So you can see the film for you, and then you can write a draft for the producers.
Yeah.
But you have the idea, you have the film like a, and you can say, okay, you can put, okay, the character wants to leave the house. So you can put on words some things, and it's like just for the producers. I don't know, but we were trying.
But my first with the girls were when it was written very, like, with the edit. Like, you can see all these images. And because I just tape something which I imagine. And this is not a good way too, because during the editing, I need more air. And I need more air in lines, in some relationships, and I didn't have it. Because I wrote the script with the edit. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And now I know this moment, and when I'm writing some lines and some character and I put double to sin, because I know that during the editing maybe I need to show more about some characters, about some moments, but I'm not sure, and because I want to have some choice, because the girls I had some problems with the editing, because I need more. A little bit, maybe 1 or 2 seconds, but I didn't have it. Yes, it was one of the main problems.
So the guide to the story about this young woman, she's married to a fisherman in a small fishing village. It's quite a claustrophobic society, and her husband goes missing while on a fishing trip, and this could be her chance actually to leave this place, to get out of there. And her mother-in-law, as you could just see, blames her for everything. And I think you could also see in this clip the mystic element there is, and that is also something that is in your new project, Tachal. Tachal is, I mean, I can tell now as if I knew, I had no idea before. Tachal is the connection between the living and the dead. In karmic belief, it's very close to Buddhist beliefs, and so if a person that was close to you dies and you still have some unfinished business, some unfinished things, they stay connected. And this is actually something that there are psychotherapists and psychiatrists in Kalmykia who deal with victims of this tachal. And I think it's very interesting in your case now that there's really a process for you to develop this script, because you don't just sit there and write from what you know, but you actually went to Kalmykia quite recently and did research, and maybe you can tell us something about this.
The difference between the girls and the tachal, because the girls was my my own story. It's not the story, but it's atmosphere and some problems maybe. But tachal, it's just a figment of my imagination. And in Kalmyk culture, we have some old words which means a lot. And if you want to discover some cultural, you have to see the birth, wedding, and death. And this film about the death, and I created this story and I wrote this story, and one moment some crisis began to my mind, and I didn't go out from this stop in my mind. I stopped to feel the script at one moment, and with the script consultant, because it can help you if you stop to feel. It's very important to be alive in your idea, and I decided to go to Kalmykia, and we shot some documentary research about this meaning, and we asked some Kalmyk people from different sites, please explain us how you explain us about this meaning, tachal? And we asked the Buddhist Lama, shaman, medium, medicaster, and some simple people who know about it from the memory of his of their parents or grandmothers and fathers, and psychotherapist who is Kalmyk, and she know what I mean, but she explained us from the view of therapists about this illness, and it was really helpful for me. It was like a fresh air, because they and we make some rituals. I don't know, maybe these rituals help me to finish my script, because after this trip, I finished my script, and now I have a final version of the script and really like it. At first, it is the first time when I like it, really like it. And I know what I know, and now it doesn't matter. Some producers, if they don't like my script, it's not my problem now. Because it was my problem when I, with the last versions, I wanted to listen about some advices or something, and now I don't need it. And I think it's one of the main moments when you don't need some advices, and you stop to ask people what I have to change, maybe. Maybe this way or this way now, and now I know that this is my story. I want to show it, yes. And sometimes you need to go inside, and you have to recall your recall your memory or memory from the past or some the natural energy, God energy, and it can help you to refresh some feelings and some kind, and to finish and decide all your problem in your mind, because it was a big crisis for me. It was, I can't do anything. You know, my children there was working around me, mama, what's happened? Why are you so strange? Yes.
That at least sounds like an happy end, that, you know, throughout the process, you know, do you also have that there's a time where you're really happy for input, and then at one point you decide, because I'm wondering, when do you know now the script is final?
now this is my story, and now whoever wants to say something, shut up until I'm in the edit or something. Do you have that too, that you know at a certain moment now's the way to go on set?
No. No, never. No, never. There sometimes you go in the shooting process with a script that you don't like it, and you have to change it in the shooting process. And it's I think it's normal because the film will be done. It's like three processes, like the writing process, the shooting process, and the editing process. So it's very difficult to say, okay, this is the script I want to do. For me, it's very difficult. I need to, and I will change it a lot in the shooting process, because sometimes I think, oh, this is a very good scene. I like it in the script, in paper, and then you go into the shooting process and it's horrible. And that scene is linked to another scene and to the whole story. So you have to be prepared to change. And everybody asked me, do you have the characters and the places and everything while you write in the script? Thankfully, not. I want to discover it with my crew, with the DOP, with the art director, with the costume designer, everybody. It's very strange to say that, because you're supposed to be the director and you're supposed to be the one who knows everything, but that's a lie. I think that's a lie. You have to know something about every department, but there's people, professionals in every department, like a DOP. For example, in Dog Season, we create a very good bonding between the characters, between Moco and Flama, the two teenagers, with the custom designer, because we decided to take them to a flea market to buy their own costume. And then they found a punk thing with
spikes on it.
Spikes, yes, yeah. Like a very tough and punk attitude. And we wrote a story about that thing, because one of them gave it to the other. So it was that kind of thing that you are finding on the process and with the makeup process. We said we don't want makeup, so that's when what you're learning with the people. So you never know when the script is ready, and maybe you can spend a long time trying to say, okay, this is the script I want to shoot. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's not mm-hmm. there, and you ask about the directors and writers, mm-hmm. and I will ask editors. Mm-hmm. Yes, and that's the problem. No, because a film is done in the editing room. You go. The most important thing is the editing room. You make a film for the editing room. So I'm really impressed that there is no editors and that all
you can change the story.
Yes, it's a rewriting process, but completely a rewriting process. For me, the editor is like the Dog Season. The first cut was horrible, but horrible, not really, really. When we saw that first cut, I swear, I called my wife and I told her, we need to go out of the country because they will take us on jail. No, I swear, really, it was horrible because it was this story with four characters, a choral story, so it was a mess, it was horrible. And the editor, with patience, with love, with a very profound knowledge of dramatic structure, she worked and worked and worked and worked. And one of the things, one of the most important things that happened with that film, so be aware of the festivals, is that we sent that first cut to the Berlinale. And thankfully, they saw it and they rejected it. So that gave us the time to say, okay, this is not working, this is not good. So we took a long time, like 4 months, working every day. So we found the film there. So it was really, really, we were really lucky. And that's also because be afraid of the festivals and the deadlines of the festivals, because the producers, they will always want to, okay, this can, this is the Berlinale, so let's send the film right now. So you have to have times. And sometimes the rejections actually are really good and they're meaning something.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for mentioning that. That is really an important aspect. Yes?
Yeah, I like really much the, your approach to a movie because it's just like a football trainer. You have a football team, no? And there are all these three phases of the process. And what I would like to ask you is into which part, also part two and three, shooting and editing, where have you more fun and how? And how is important also this kind of okay, we are doing a playing together. And in which part, in which phases is most important for you?
The most important is the editing process. Is the most important is the part where I really enjoy it and I'm finding the film. It's the most important part. The other is like you're trying to guess if things will fit together, of if there will be a tone, but it's impossible to go and say, okay, I will find the tone. It's impossible. It's something like, I hate that kind of term, but it's something like from here. It's like some tone that you are trying to give the film since all the with all the scenes. But you will find that tone in the editing room. So if you have an editor that it's a sensitive person and has the chance or the capacity to find that tone, you are very lucky. And that takes a time. That's why the editing process takes so much. It's so long and so painful. But it's like I'm always impressed because it's like a chemistry or magic process. It's like, I love to stay there. I don't edit, but I stay there all days, from 9 to 5, all days. And sitting in a sofa,
and
talking
sometimes
with the,
you're sleeping on the sofa.
No, but thankfully my the editor, she's a very, very, very intelligent person. I like to talk about her and we, all the time it's like, okay, let's have a break. And we can have breaks like for 2 hours, like smoking and drinking coffee. But talking about the film and other films and about our families and things. So it's a very intimate process. But I could not imagine like an editor saying, okay, we have to work. Or, okay, the film, I we had a contract for 3 months, so let's do it. No, it's a very human process, and I really enjoy it.
Hi, and thanks for sharing. I just would like to ask, at what stage in the writing process or the pre-production do you involve the cinematographer, the art director, and wardrobe? Is that in like between drafts, or is it later? Or
in which process we involve the cinematographer and the producers and No, I should go with them with the script. What I think is the a good script to show them. So I think they're the first filter, like the DOP and the producers and yes, it's a. Bergman used to say that the script was like a love letter to his crew, and maybe he was right. Yes, you have to how to involve them, how to believe in the story because they are the ones that will go. No, so if you have a DOP that doesn't care about the story, it will be like okay, I will do it. I don't know, 6 weeks, 7 weeks. I have my check and bye. That's horrible. Mm-hmm. So you have to make a good script for them.
Do you remember any moment where, because I mean, your crew is also your first audience in a way, right? And your producers are your first audience. And do you remember any in any of your films incident where that was really eye-opening, where you in a positive or negative way, where you thought, oh my goodness, I thought this would come across completely differently, and then you had the response from the outside, and this made you change a scene, the whole script, your idea? Or was it always, you know, was it what you expected?
the reactions? Did you have, you know, this, what they always say, you get this reality check when you first enter a market, for instance, and then this sales agent tells you, you know, that you're, that your film doesn't stand a chance on in this territory because da 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 da. Did you have to encounter any of that throughout the last, like during the residency, even when you met with consultants and you thought, oh no, I really, like if I want to reach this or that audience?
When we made the calls, I didn't care about the audience mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm. I was making it just for myself, I'm mm-hmm. sorry. And it was, from the one side, it was nice because I was free and I didn't expect anything. Yes, I wanted to go to the festival because I was in Berlinale Talents, mm-hmm. but it was not the main goal because it's the first, the main was to have a voice, to make this movie, mm-hmm. because I wrote the script and I see these pictures, and the second moment, the Tachal, mm-hmm. it's a little bit different because during our world premiere, when you see the full cinema, a lot of people they came to watch your film, and the first thing it was, oh my God. All people, they have my film could be interested in the audience. I am so happy, but it's a little bit difference between the festival audience and the audience, mm-hmm. because all these people, they came not in your film, they came to the brand Berlinale, and what was the main reason was, it was the main. It's not a problem. But you have to understand this moment. And when I was writing the Tachal, yes, of course, I wanted to white this audience because I realized that I'd want to shoot this a little bit selfish to shoot just for yourself because I need the audience. I want to shoot for the audience and I want to have some connection with the audience. And I don't want to shoot just for me and for my family and for my friends who can say you shot a good film or for just for critics, for what?
But
yeah.
What an audience means? It's very difficult because it's very general.
I was just going to ask because I know, like in your case, it sounds a bit like you lost in a way a bit of your innocence that you had in the first. You know, in the first you were just with yourself, there was this story that needed to get out there, and then you entered this whole circus of, you know, festival premieres, attention, and so on. And now you are aware of this, and you have already had great success and had your film in the Berlinale, and now there's maybe more pressure than there was before with your first one. But when you now say, now you would like to reach an audience, but how does it influence your writing? Like, I can't imagine you sitting there at your desk thinking, okay, if I write the scene like this, it won't reach an audience, but if I write it like this, it might reach an audience. You don't do this, do you? I mean, yes, you just write, and whatever happens afterwards, no? Tell me, give me an example.
No, it's okay. Now I'm lying here exactly because when I'm writing, I don't think about the audience. Yes, yeah. Yes, I don't. But in generally, I want to create some story more general, more attractive, more emotional. I don't know, but. But I hope my next film will find more white audience it's more faster than the girls, for example. And I think by myself, but like a director, what do you think? Yes, I think I have to show the film for the audience. But inside, I'm who I am. and I can write what I can do. And because nobody can, please write this script. You have to, for this generation, 14, your audience, target audience, 14, 19, and no, it's not a work because it's an art house film, and it's, yes.
I think it's very difficult to define an audience. It's very general. It's impossible to say, okay, I want to, it's like an
maybe you won't, but
audience, yeah. Like that. So it's impossible to write to the audience. It's like writing to no one. Because if I said, okay, the audience is this, and you are very different from her, and you're very different from him, very different. It's I found there's not so much sense in called an audience. I once read a Stephen King book that it's really beautiful. It's about the writing process, and he said that he had like the perfect reader, the for him. He said, okay, it could be my wife, it could be a friend, it could be someone. So you try to write for that perfect reader. And I think as a filmmaker, you go for the perfect viewer. It could be your friend. It could be a friend that you had 20 years ago. But you want to because if not, I think that when you try to write just for yourself, maybe it's not like a drive, like a trying to tell something to another person. I think that I tried that to find that perfect viewer, and I think that could work, because that perfect viewer shares your some kind of point of views, your way of thinking, your thing. So I think that could help, because the audience is impossible to know which the audience could be.
I'd imagine it would also sort of block you, like if you were really trying to imagine all those people out there, would only result in you writing nothing, probably.
Yes. If I'm writing a scene and I think of the audience and I think on my mother, on the producer, on the other producer, it would be very difficult to find which I would please. Mm. And I think as a filmmaker, you want to a lot of people to see your film, but it's impossible to think in terms of audience. I really believe in that perfect viewer.
Has it become easier or more difficult for you throughout the years, like now working on the fourth film?
It's just the same. Everybody says, okay, it's the fourth film, so it will be easier to find the money, the funding, everything. But the main conflict, the main obstacles is the director of the film. Mm-hmm. Okay. One. It's the main obstacle conflict, yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about Diary of an Elephant, the project you're working on right now, where you are in this part of the process?
Yes. In the residency, I had the chance to have advisors, and there was, thankfully, a lot of questions, not point of views about the story, but questions and questions and questions and questions. And I took that questions, I put it on a paper, and I'm trying to answer those questions. Some of them make sense, some of them don't, but I consider that questions. And right now I decided to work not with a screenwriter, but with a writer, because sometimes I think that the screenwriters, there are a lot of ways of working that it's very technical, yes, and I think that maybe that's not so good sometimes. Sometimes the best way to go is like a step out outline. Sometimes writing biographies. Sometimes we are writing short stories about the characters, like scenes or short stories. So yes, and it's good to talk with someone. And I had a a problem with a character because I was so near, and it was getting very difficult to work with that character. So this writer, she's working on this character. She doesn't have an issue with that character. So she writes and says things, and I read the things that she wrote, and it's like, that's horrible. And she was like, yes, yes, that happens. Yes.
And you, in Club Sandwich, you worked with another director on the characters, right? Wasn't it when you started working with Rodrigo García?
In Club Sandwich?
Or was it now that you work with him now on the characters?
No, Rodrigo, he helped me, Rodrigo García, he helped me in the editing process. Ah. That was a rewriting process. Yes.
Editing again.
Editing. Yes.
Cool. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Yeah?
Hello. Sorry for the voice. We'd like to know also how the residence works. I mean, how long is it? Is it 6 months or like the Binger Lab or something like that? How do you work? How can you apply, for example, the requirements? And for Fernando and a girl, I can't remember her name. Sorry,
Ella.
But what was the expectations of the residency, and how are they working right now? What they que tienen que hacer al final? What should you do at the end, or you know, all these technical facts to apply to for a residence.
I do the technical, and then you do the what it was like, the experience. Okay, the residency is for 3 months. You get €1,500 per month. You find your own place to live, which is in Berlin still possible. It's getting more complicated, but it's still possible. And the program is, I'd say it's quite a loose program, because all we do is we try to provide you with people who can support you, but it's up to you how much support you want. So each of the filmmakers has a script consultant, an industry mentor, who are individually for them. Then we try to do sessions where, like in the beginning of the 3 months, the guys screened their films to each other, so that they knew, okay, Ella is coming from there, Fernando from there, that's what they've done before. And then they talk to each other about their new project, because, you know, as you can see, especially Fernando, I think, is always very keen on having other creative people to exchange ideas with and to help each other. And the third filmmaker we had in the residency, for instance, is called Daniel Borgman. He's a director from New Zealand who works in Denmark. He made his first feature called The Weight of Elephants, which screened in Forum in 2013. And he was working on a project, or still is, that is very documentary-like. And it's really a pity that he can't be here today, also because it is a very process-driven, as he calls it, process, because he's been going back and forth he makes a film about a woman who's slightly mentally disabled, and she lives in a remote countryside in Denmark. She's in her 60s, and she lives with her mother, who's already 84. And he was interested in this codependency of these two women, one being the old woman having her daughter, and one being the slightly mentally challenged daughter being dependent on her old mother, and asking questions, what do I do when she's not there anymore? And so he's been spending a lot of time with these two women. And initially he had the idea of writing a script, but then he filmed a lot, and then the women took over in a way. And now I think for him also the most important thing will be the editing room, and how does he gain control again of this thing that he started. And I know that you very often talk to Daniel about it, and you know, so what we try to do is just create situations where exchange is possible, where we can help. We try to connect the filmmakers to the Berlin industry, to the festival family,
you know, to sort of include them in support them in whatever way we can. And then the second part, like after the 3 months that they are here and meet in regular intervals, but not, it's not very scholarly or anything. We don't have like every week a session or a class or something. And then the second part is returning to Berlin to the co-production market, because this is a thing which is for us, of course, very easy. I mean, the festival, having the European film market connected to it and the co-production market, it would be silly not to use this. So we can help projects in a wider way, because at the co-production market, we have an audience of participants, 500 people who work in international co-productions. We have producers, sales agents, distributors, funders, financiers, broadcasters. And they know that we make a selection of projects for them every year. And the 3 residency projects are included in the selection. We make a catalog where we present the project. We send that to those 500 who registered, all companies with good track records, with international experience, with great credits to their names. And they then tell us, oh, I'd really be interested in meeting this project, that project, and so on. And then we set up one-on-one meetings between the project and the potential partners and financiers. So within 2 days of meetings, I mean, these guys spend Sunday and Monday talking nonstop. It's like they have their table there, they've got their meeting schedule. Every 30 minutes, a new person comes, and you know, you talk about your project over and over again. By the end of it, you can't remember whether you already said this to this person or that person. But anyway, it's great to meet a lot of people in quite a short time span, because, I mean, as you all know, making films is a very collaborative process, and producing a film is like, a lot of people say that, and I agree, you enter marriage in a way. You know, you work for a long time together. There'll be very stressful situations, and it's very important to also connect on a personal level, not just say, oh, I'd really like to work with this guy because he produced this fantastic film and so on. But if you don't get along. So festivals for us and markets are really, I call myself a matchmaker in a way. I try to connect people to each other who then do the great work. And when you meet someone face to face, you guys have to say this, but I think you can instantly feel, could this work or not? And then after the festival, after the market, you can follow up and see, are they still interested? Would I still be interested? And then we can maybe work together. So this was the part of the technical thing, but you also asked about the experience and expectations.
When I was in Berlinale Talents and 3 years ago, I saw this brochure. When I saw some faces, the participant of the Berlinale Residency, and for me it was like, oh my God, they are like stars for me, yeah, and yes, it was like my, I wanted to apply, but at that moment I didn't have any feature film, and maybe in the future. Yes, but after Berlinale Forum, it was possible to apply. And I didn't expect it that you select me, but at one moment they called me and say, oh, hello, how are you? Do you have a friend in Berlin? It was a good sign, I think so. Yeah. And when I came, I was really excited because, and afraid a little bit because I didn't know what I have to do. Maybe I have to go every day. It's like a school, maybe. Yes, but it was really nice and free, and I feel I can do what you can do what you want. You can write or just walk in the zoologistic garden, and. And my script consultant was really nice for me, and she knows about my culture a lot because I think she prepared very properly, and she knows about Buddhist cultural, And I was surprised, really surprised. And thank you for Berlinale Residency, because I didn't expect it, this this kind of consultant. And Karsten, he was my film mentor, and he speaks Russian. It was easier to speak with him, and he understands a lot, and he knows about Russia. And it was really helpful. And all this, for me, it was easier than I expected, maybe. But some pressure, yes, I felt some. But I have to finish. But you don't have, no, maybe. But you, it's better for you. And it's really nice that nobody tell you that you have to finish if you don't finish. No, it's it was really nice and free and very comfortable, because everybody care about you during these 3 months. And it was a good opportunity to present our project in the co-production market, because face-to-face you can see and meet and present your projects so close, and explain what you want and what about your projects. It's really nice, and it's a great opportunity. Yeah.
I know you felt the pressure with the deadline.
Yes.
Because they are, like, we have towards the end of the residency, we do a workshop where we also invite the producers. And we invite a couple of industry people. So there was a sales agent, there was a distributor, another producer who gave feedback, you know. So like one of those first audiences, or people who know that this is still a lab, you know, they shouldn't be. I think what makes it, or what we are trying to create, is this room where the filmmakers have air to breathe and can work, get supported and feel safe, you know, because it is still a process, and not everyone feels comfortable sharing the idea. So whoever mentor we bring into the circle, these are people we trust, and we know that they understand the whole process, and that like this thing, you know, what we do in this room stays in this room. Basically.
Well, if the residency, if you are looking for answers, don't apply. It's just questions and questions and questions. It's about that, to question your ways of working, your ways of of producing. There's a script advisor that he helps you a lot, and if you need another advice or another point of view, they will support you on that. And it's great. There's it's not deadlines, but it helps you to have some meetings with your advisors, so you can ask yourself what is happening with your writing process. And then you have this industry advisor that at the moment I thought, oh, what's this about? I'm writing the script and it was really confusing. So I had a meeting with him and it was like, I don't understand. So, but then I realized why there's the industry advisor, because a film is not about just the director. A film is about the director, the DOP, the editor, and the producer. And in this residency, you begin to understand that the producer is a creative part of the process. That it's really important to have a creative partner, in terms of production. It's really important how you want to make the film. If you don't involve in that process of finding money, fundings, everything, you don't know how will be your film. You must be involved on that process, and don't see the producer like that's the enemy, or that's the one who goes for the money. The producer are there because they love the projects, and. In my previous films, I wasn't so involved on that process, and I was really afraid of the sales agent and the distributors and the co-productions, because the industry tends to show like that, like they're another people, and it's really important to know them, to speak with them, to They're creative partners. We had a lot of meetings. It was really exhausting. And yes, you can see that all the people that sit there are looking for creative people, and they want to be creative partners. And they're there because the films, not because the money, because maybe they can do another job that make a lot of money, not films.
You ask about the application and the requirements. We only accept applications by writer directors, because it just doesn't make sense if the director comes and the writer is at home in a completely different time zone or something. And we want the writer directors to already have directed at least one feature-length film, be it documentary or fiction. And this film needs to have screened at one of the international A-list film festivals. For the new project, which you apply with, there needs to be a producer on board. And it shouldn't be just the first draft or a treatment stage. We want, because, you know, it's time-wise, the co-production market, the Berlinale, is in February. So when you count back, we started in September until the end of November, and you just need to make sure that by the time the Berlinale comes, there is a script that you feel comfortable sharing, because whoever you meet during the festival will say, I'm interested in your project, send me your script. And you don't want to lose, I mean, a festival creates this extreme buzz. There's this attention then for your project, and there's this energy that you can really use to push your project forward. And if you then need to return to your room and write for another 9 months before you can show something to your partners, they have gone on to other projects. So we try to already, at the time of application, while we select projects, we already have in mind, will they be far enough developed throughout those 3 months in autumn and then be ready in February to be shown on an international market such as ours? Unfortunately, there won't be any residency this year. So in 2017 is the next edition.
And I have a question for Ella. And I just point out, also in your two clips, that you have also beautiful mysticism, and you point this mysticism with cool sound and music, for example, in the first clip with the ships. And my question is, in which stage of the process do you start to think about sound and music? And because I think this is quite a big part of this atmosphere. And how do you point this out in your script when you begin to write? As you point out, okay, this sort of things, this art of things that you cannot write with words?
I don't know, maybe. My first education, I graduated the university as a sound director. Like, this is my first education. And I was working on cinema as a sound director. And I used to play the violin 14 years, and maybe this background, it helped me to create some music and during the writing. And it was not so easy, and I think it was a big problem to find the composer, because my music background was really it didn't work and didn't help me, because I wanted to explain more than I need, because my knowledge, I think it was really bad moment when I wanted to explain to composer. And I tried not once, maybe twice or three times, and they didn't understand me, what I want, because, and Anton Silev, this is our composer, I was so happy that at one moment he understood what I want, and we created this like sound mix. Yes.
But it's amazing in Ella's film that she was a violin player. Well, you are, but you don't want violin player. You used to play violin.
Yeah, violin, yeah.
So you can feel that in the film. It's the rhythm with the images, with the sound. It's there. She that's why I think that's why she had so much problems with the music, because yes, because it was.
But speaking about music, what's with that Beatles song? Do you want to talk about the Beatles song for Duck Season, where you had this, you wanted to get this, wasn't it that way, like on the balcony, when they stand on the balcony? Uh-huh. Wasn't it?
Well, we never thought about putting a Beatles song because it was impossible. But I love the Beatles. I really love the Beatles, so I want to make an homage. So there's an image with the Beatles there.
And they might appear again in your new project, no?
Maybe, maybe. But it's really, really difficult to find a Beatles.
To pay for
the Beatles.
Song is very difficult.
Yes.
But there was another question, right?
I have a question for both of you. I'm a writer-director. Fernando, you spoke a bit about the film evolves when you're making it and with the designer and everyone else. And I think you're right. I think that's sort of been my experience a bit. But also, the clip from Duck Season, which is such a beautiful film, it's beautifully directed. It's so specific, it's so precise, it's so visual. And that shot that we saw, it's a single take. There's no cutting. And I'm just wondering, when you're writing, do you have any of that in your head? Or do you just deliberately shut all of the actual shots or whatever out of your head to write? And that's, I guess, to both of you, but I haven't seen your film either. But do you ever allow yourself to sort of make the movie in your head? Or do you just leave it to one side?
No, when I'm writing, I don't have the image in my head or the sounds. No, I'm just I don't know. They doesn't appear. Maybe it's a bad thing, but they doesn't appear. And we go into the scouting and the pre-shooting. We go to the location, and with the DOP, we spend there like weeks. Trying to figure out if the camera could work there, and maybe we can shoot it here and then cut here, and then we think that we have the scene, well, design it to start with, and then we start rehearsing with the actors, figure out if it works with the actors. Sometimes it doesn't work, so we change the camera, the place of the camera. We said to the actors, okay, let's see us in 2 hours, and we redesign the scene. It has to be with the rhythm, with the yes, it's but yes, we the photographer is really important. I was really lucky because I worked with one of the best DOPs for me, that it's Alexis Abe, and it was really, really I learned a lot from him, but I let him put the camera. I had an idea, and we did a short film before, and I had an idea, but we built that in the shooting. No, what is it? Scouting. It's yes, and with the first ID, it's really important, because the first ID will go like, okay, this scene will be shot like this, and she write it, and cut here, and she write it. So there's a plan. So it's impossible, well, it's always possible, but it's impossible to get lost during the shooting process, that you don't have time to think or to, oh, this is a good idea. No, you have to go like this. So.
In my case, DOP was, he's my husband, and and he was involved from the beginning, before beginning. Yes, I have this opportunity without money, and but for nervous. Yes, it's very expensive. And I imagined some pictures when I was writing this script, but At one moment when during this shooting, teaser shooting, we came to our one of the great Kelmic painter. He's my uncle, and I asked him, please, can we need some examples, some key for my movie, and I don't have this any idea because I can't find in my mind some picture. Please help us. And he showed us a lot of pictures by Kelmic painters, and it was a graphic, old graphic or new modern painter, but we didn't have any, we didn't find any good idea for us. But at one moment he showed us one very small picture, and it was a step there with a it's a highway, like a highway, like road, road, yes, and stepper was the house, stepper was covered them. Snow, and it was a very dirty snow, and from the first line was some red detail, and it was a yes, this one, and with this small picture was a key for all the movie, and we found this. And when the teaser was released in the internet, and the author of this picture, he wrote the message, and he didn't know that his picture was a key for our movie. And he wrote me his song. Now he lives in the United States, and he moved a lot, very long time ago. And he said, "Oh my God, what such a great picture! I really like it." And good. I'm sorry, we stole your style and idea, and if not, it's not. I'm not surprised that you like it because this is your. Yes, it was a beautiful story. About.
Hi. What are your ways to find a producer? What are your methods to make interested a producer of with your story, with your project? And is it the first step after writing? Is looking for a producer first step after writing a screenplay, or maybe you are doing that after collecting crew and cast?
Well, I mean,
I had a producer that is, he's my partner, Jaime. He's my partner. He studied with me in the film school, so we were like a partners, creative partners, and we understand each other. So we went with an executive producer, with Christian, and we pitched him the project. And I told him, if you want to do this film, it's okay. If you don't, it doesn't matter. I will do it anyway, because it was a very simple story in an apartment in black and white, and I was really, I believe it, that I could take a video camera and shoot it at my home, at my apartment. And I think that the producer, Christian, saw that energy and saw that thing that it will go forward. So he said, no, I want to be in the film. I want to produce this film. So I don't know, maybe sometimes you need a partner, a creative partner, if you call the crew before, that's dangerous.
It's way too late also. Your producer, I don't know where this notion comes from, that a producer is an enemy. No, the producer is supposed to be your friend. He needs to be your partner in crime. You can't pull, if you want to have fun during doing what you're doing, you should better be on the same page, agree on where you want to go, share the vision, and support each other as good as you can. And in your case, I mean, Jaime and Christian are partners with Fernando in Cine Pantera in the company they have, and they've been producing the films together ever since the first one. And there's, it depends on, it really depends on what kind of person you are. You have to ask yourself, what do I want from my producer? Do I want this remote person who just makes sure the checks are paid? Do I want a mom who organizes my entire life so I can concentrate on what I'm doing? Or do I want a partner on the same level and someone who I need in a creative way? I think that is the ideal relationship in my view, but it's completely up to you who you're looking for. But this needs to be clear from the very start. What do you expect from each other? Otherwise, it won't work. Yeah, but are you just looking for money? Like, is the producer supposed to be like this uncle in America who sends a check and leaves you alone the rest of the time? You know, it's really up to you who
money?
You want.
But it's not, it sounds stupid, but it's not so important, the money. If you want to make the film, it's not about money. If you don't make the film, it's because of you. Because your fears, because your things, and you should be involved in the financing process, in the money process. You should, like, right now the screenwriters in the TV series, they are really involved in the projects. They are producer of the projects. They write and they produce. It's really important to be involved, really involved.
Saying the money is not important comes from the Mexican guy who's got, I mean, they have the funding system, mise-en-scene, like Fernando would get about 80% of his budget from his country, from mise-en-scene. Depending on where you're from, money is a huge issue.
No,
and you need producers to get the money.
No, but this I learned it from Paula Markovic. Really, really, really. When we did Doc Season, there was not this tax incentive. In Mexico, and everybody, we did a workshop, and everybody on the workshop, we were like five persons, and everybody run out of the workshop because they had to work, they had to, so they did TV commercial, that kind of thing. And Paula and I were like this, like this, like this. And I remember Paula said, everybody says that to make a film, they need money. And the money is not the issue. The money is, it's the pretext or the excuse. It's big. I said, okay, I need to make a first film. I don't have any, I did short films, but it will be really difficult to convince a producer. So I said, okay, I need to make a very, very, very simple film. If I don't find the money, what could I do? So I just said, okay, let's do a film in an apartment with four characters, just in an apartment with available light. No lights, not nothing, no effects, no nothing. So I wrote the script, and when I sit with the producer, who is the one who should find the money, I said, I will make this film with money or with not money. And he felt that the input, and he said, okay, I want to go. And there was not that incentive. And when we present the film Doc Season to the committee in Mexico for another fund, it was really, really difficult to convince them. And we had to look for there's product placement there in the film. I hate product placement, but there was product placement. And it was difficult. It was difficult. And right now, with the incentive that you're talking about, I'm here in the co-production market talking about co-production, because that's really interesting, and you have to be involved in the ways of making a film. So it's
for Ella, I know it was very important to find the support of Elena to be able to make the film.
My way, a little bit, it's different because I really want to be involved in the film industry, because I didn't want to make the film just in by myself with my family. You know, I have some. And because I need to present myself, my culture, because we are here and we have some stories. I want to talk about the cultures, about my some part of we are the family, and I'm a part of this family, because a lot of small nationalities in Russia, they are shooting their in that place, in their own place, some movies, but nobody see this movie. Nobody.
You see yourself as the ambassador of, you know, ethnic minorities, and in your case, Kalmykia, to get the stories out into
and
the world.
I was really lucky. 3 years ago, I was in Berlinale Talents, and I heard something very important for me, some knowledge. And it was really helpful for me, because at that moment, I was like a broken bird, and nobody believed me. When I returned, I become more confident, because yes, I'm Kalmyk. I don't want to shoot a commercial movie or create a story, write a story about the Russian or Moscow life, because I know what I want. I want to tell about my culture. It was really important for me, and I think just about it. And it was really important for me to find the Russian producer with the name. And when we met with Yelena, I met her on the road, during the Russian Film Festival Kinotavr, and I say, hello, I'm Ella, did you read my script, and I want to work with you, and it was a moment when we started to work. I just saw her and start to talk with her, and it was not so easy before, but when I started to talk, it was easy.
At a festival, great place to meet people. Just to say, time is up. I'd be happy to take more questions if you are too. If anyone needs to go to their next appointment, fine, I don't mind. We can continue for a couple of minutes to answer the,
Hi, I'm a screenwriter and a script reader, and I was just curious, for both of you, what's the most difficult writing decision you ever had to make? Did you ever write 20 drafts and realize that you have the wrong protagonist or something like that?
Go in the next draft. Don't go for 20 drafts. No, I think that it could be dangerous for the script to make a lot of drafts. I think that from the one draft to the other, it's a big decision. When you will start that draft, and a lot of things must change, but deep things. So writing a lot of drafts, I don't know, maybe it's, I think it's very, it's a bit dangerous.
But just to see, how many more questions, then we put an end to it. So one more here, okay.
Yes, hi. I've been trying to write a script. I'm mainly an actor, but I'd like to direct and write. And I have a huge problem. It's a comedy, and I don't know. I have the problem of style. So I don't know when you're writing, because I have the feeling there are many ways of acting, of showing comedy. You can have a burlesque comedy. You can have something maybe like Gustave Kervin, which is, you know, a more social comedy, a little off. And I have the feeling I've never directed a long movie before, so there's these questions: should I know this before, or should I just write? And will eventually it come out of the story itself? For instance, also how a film looks. So here, your movie was in black and white. Is this things as a director that you already knew when you were writing, or did they kind of emerge? But the style, for me, style is very important, because it's also the heart of the movie for both of you.
Comedy?
Comedy for Ella.
She doesn't like comedy. I love comedy. To write comedy is one of the most difficult things to do. Billy Wilder, he used to have a big note that is here in the museum in Berlin, that says what Lubitsch had done, no? So it's about the Lubitsch and the comedy. No, I don't know. And don't think about the genre. It's the genre. I hate that word. It doesn't matter. Once I was talking with Carlos Cuarón. He's a very good friend of mine. And he told me that the jar is not, doesn't, is not useful. It's about tone. And the tone, I had to be like a, not so practical, but tone is about this. So don't think about the jar. Just write it.
Don't elevate journal.
Eh? Don't do what?
Elevate journal.
Yes. So don't write it, and if you like it, you laugh, it's okay. And the most difficult part will be when you go into the set, and that scene that you thought that it was, wow, hilarious, will be really boring. So you have a problem, so you have to deal with that and to construct the scene in ways of comedy.
And you knew you wanted to shoot in black and white?
No. Actually, it was a problem with the producer, because this in the book, in the handbook, it's like no black and white films. So it was a problem because he was already on the film. We found some product placement from Xbox and that kind of things. And when we told them it was black and white, they took the money out. They told us, okay, we can give you an Xbox. They were like, thank you, but no money. And the producers had the financial plan, everything. So it was like a mess. And we took the decision, we don't know, with the DOP. We said, okay, maybe let's think about it. How could it work in black and white? And then we realized that it could work, so we went into black and white.
All right. So I know we ran over time. We're going to stop here. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Ella. Thank you.